Today, we're going to examine the need for more research, systemic research, in terms of marijuana related to disease treatment and prevention relative to whether it's Alzheimer's or glaucoma, epilepsy. There is important research that shows that marijuana can play important scientific roles in the treatment of these various diseases or disorders. In animal testing relative to epilepsy, like seizures, marijuana introduced seems to limit or eradicate seizures. In Alzheimer's, there seems to be important action that takes place in terms of the advancement of Alzheimer's-related connections in the brain. Glaucoma seems to be one of the most promising areas in which marijuana plays a role and can truly prevent the erosion of vision. So I'm very happy that the AAAS and the Dana Foundation, working together with my staff, I want to acknowledge Brendan Cheney, who does this work in my office for the our Neuroscience Initiative, which is all-encompassing. And for those who haven't followed this work, we invite you to take a look at it. We have a major initiative around mapping the brain. We've just passed legislation to create a National Brain Observatory through the National Science Foundation. And there's some transformative news coming forward about some of the exciting work that's being done. But these briefings are specifically focused on grabbing people and making sure that you have some actual updated information about the current research. So you're going to hear from a great group of experts today, both in and outside of the government. But needless to say, the most important thing you need to know is that most of the research on marijuana has been around the use for recreational purposes and whether or not that causes or continues to move people in ways that may be antisocial or have other adverse effects. Very little, or less than 6% of the research has been focused on what marijuana may be able to do relative to actual treatment and prevention of diseases or disorders of the brain. So this is an important discussion, and I hope that you get a great deal out of it. So I want to thank you and thank the Foundation and AAAS for working with us. And we'll be back soon with another briefing and lunch for you all again in the near future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congressman. We have a fantastic panel for you today. Before we start, the necessary disclaimer, AAAS is all about the science. We don't take a position on marijuana policies, and any opinions are the speaker's own. With that, I'd like to welcome up our first speaker, Dr. Nora Volkow. She is director of the National Institute on Drug Abuse at the National Institutes of Health, and you'll find her wonderful bio and all the speaker bios in your program.
Thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here to speak about marijuana and a topic of enormous amount of interest. My presentation will actually be very short and focus right now on what we know with respect to marijuana as a drug and its effects on the developing brain. This is one of the things why I completely echo the need for more research when we have a change on the landscape as it relates to the use of marijuana. As you see here, since 1991 to now, comparing the prevalence rates of tobacco as described by the last month exposure versus alcohol versus cigarettes, you can see that since on the past 3 years, we have seen higher number of adolescents, teenagers, this is kids that are on the 12th graders, 17 to 18 years of age, that report that they've smoked marijuana in the past month, that they report they smoke tobacco. And the same, actually, this is the first time we've ever seen that phenomena, which obviously reflects the fact that normative changes are occurring throughout the whole United States that are affecting not just the adult population, but also the adolescents. And this is very clearly illustrated here which is a very good map, and Dr. Pacula will get you into it in terms of understanding that diversity on the ways that the different states are making marijuana available, either for recreational purposes or for medicinal purposes. Whatever the intervention, which is very heterogeneous, the bottom line is that there is an increased belief by the public that marijuana use is not harmful, and there is an increased belief that, in fact, marijuana abuse is beneficial. And we know that, that perception that the drug is not harmful will influence the extent to which teenagers will experiment with a drug and will use it regularly. Now, this is one of the aspects that, too, we are observing, and I think it's an incredibly important opportunity that we extract information as the different states come up with policy changes to try to understand what are the consequences so that we can learn from that and anticipate them in future changes in policy that can minimize the adverse effects of that exposure, that this exposure and legal changes have in the population. For example, if you look at the data in terms of average past month use by 12 to 17 years of age, depending on whether you're on a non-medical, a medical, or a recreational marijuana, you can see that in the recreational marijuana state, there is a much higher prevalence of use of marijuana. And when you compare, actually, the national average to Colorado average, which is the state that has been more aggressive in terms of its implementation of a legacy that will make it much more easily available and acceptable, you actually see that you also see a divergence in the prevalence rate as it compares much higher with the national levels. And I highlight this because neither Colorado nor Washington nor Alaska have legalized marijuana recreationally for teenagers. And in fact, they explicitly not legalized marijuana for teenagers. But the consequences are that even though it's not intended to make it available for teenagers, these changes are affecting them. Now, one of the things that is particularly of concern is how does that ultimately influence the outcomes of these teenagers? So we funded researchers to try to garner data that would provide us indicators that are likely to be important, again, in order to anticipate adverse effects. One of them, based on prior studies, has been that if you look at the literature, kids that were regular users of marijuana consistently have been shown to be much more likely to drop out of school and to do much worse in terms of their ability to get a degree. And indeed, we have seen when you track down the changes in policy in marijuana in Colorado that indeed the drug-related suspensions and exposures have significantly increased, indicating that despite the fact that these laws are not intended for adolescents, they are nonetheless influencing them. Sorry. Now, why do people take marijuana? They take marijuana predominantly because it contains a cannabinoid, 9-THC, and you will get more details from Dr. Piomelli, that actually in the brain can activate reward centers. And the way that drugs activate reward centers actually is very different, but all of them have a common effect. They increase dopamine in the nucleus accumbens, which is the main center of reward in our brains, and that stimulates them. And that is why we like to take alcohol, or why people like to smoke or take cocaine, and why they like to smoke marijuana. All of these drugs increase dopamine. Now we know, actually, that these drugs that increase dopamine, when they do that, they also produce another effect that is very important as it relates to memory and learning. When you actually get exposed to a rewarding event, that will make your brain learn that that is a pleasurable response, and that will strengthen that memory such that the next time you get exposed to it, you will actually have a strengthening of that signaling. And this is actually produced in part by the magnitude of the increases in dopamine. So drugs, for example, that increase dopamine very, very, very high levels like amphetamine will produce more intense reward and produce those changes in the memory systems, in the strengthening of these responses much more strongly than drugs like marijuana, which increase dopamine to a much lesser extent than a drug like methamphetamine or amphetamine or cocaine. And in part, these pharmacological differences determine the extent to which you will have a drug that's more or less addictive and determine how many people become addicted to it. So in the case of marijuana, however, its effects are, by which it activates the reward centers, are mediated by cannabinoid receptors, specifically cannabinoid CB1 receptors. But these CB1 receptors are not only located in the reward centers of the brain, here the nucleus accumbens, but they are densely populating our whole brain, and where they play very distinct roles. And therefore, again, highlighting the importance of understanding what are the consequences when someone is intoxicated with marijuana, not only on their behavior while they are intoxicated, but with repeated administration. How is it influencing all of these other areas of the brain that are involved with movement, vision, judgment, reward, perception, and memory? And indeed, this, for example, could explain why when people are intoxicated, they have difficulty learning and memorizing. But what the big question has always been, are there also, apart from the effect of intoxication, changes that can be long-lasting? And again, I'm going to highlight what we actually know where there is very, very strong evidence, but specifically for the developing brain. And I'm highlighting it because we now know that the human brain is very, very neuroplastic, and this neuroplasticity leads to changes that are accommodating to the environmental exposures. The brain is particularly plastic in childhood and adolescence, and therefore that explains why when they get exposed to drugs, they are much more likely to become addicted. Now, the cannabinoid system, including the CB1 receptors, appear very early on in development, and they are involved in these neuroplastic changes that are occurring as part of normal processes by which our brain develops and transforms into an adult brain, as well as the processes that allow us to adapt to the environment with adults. So a big question mark has, how does taking marijuana influence the behavior and outcomes of adolescents, and how does it influence their brains? The first big question has always been, do you become addicted if you take marijuana? And the answer is yes. There's no questions around it. Marijuana is an addictive substance. From what I show you in terms of its pharmacological effects, it's less addictive than other drugs like amphetamine, cocaine. But it is addictive, and now we know, for example, that if any out of people that get exposed, which is what you are seeing here, what percentage of them will become addicted? 9% of individuals that get exposed will become addicted to marijuana. This is less than what you see with heroin, which is a very addictive drug. However, when you look at data like this one, you have to have a caveat. This is data on populations, so you see these very high numbers with tobacco, and you see actually that don't reflect necessarily the fact that it is an addictive drug per se, because it doesn't increase dopamine so much, but it is a legal substance. And we know that the process of availability and norms will influence the likelihood that you will get repeated exposure to the drug. So as a drug becomes legal, more people get exposed to it, and therefore you will end up with more people becoming addicted because they use it more regularly. This number also reflects across all of the population. And now we know that if you start smoking marijuana before age 17, this increases, that percentage of kids that become addicted increases to 16%. And we know that kids that use regularly marijuana, the percentage that become addicted goes up to 50%. We also know, very interesting from multiple studies, that the use of marijuana, particularly very early on in adolescence, before age 17, is associated not just with an increased risk to become addicted to marijuana, but actually with an increased risk to becoming addicted to another wide variety of drugs. Again, bringing up the notion that exposure during adolescence could have very adverse effects. Another area that has been repeatedly evaluated were studies, independent laboratory reports, very similar findings, relate on ones what I was telling you, that the high school completion goes down as a function of the amount of marijuana that you get exposed to when you are an adolescent. And again, that has been replicated again and again. The same thing, degree attainment is much lower in those that are regular marijuana users as opposed to those that use it very, very rarely. What's interesting, and this is, again, the same data that I showed but a different group of investigators on a very large cohort, that cannabis dependence actually increases when you use it regularly. It also increases the use of other drugs. But very interestingly, this was a finding that actually emerge very, very strongly out of this study, which was done in three different cohorts, that the risk for suicide attempts is also associated with an increase in the daily exposure to marijuana. This is an area, of course, that requires much more investigators to see if, in fact, there is a causative link between the use of marijuana and the suicidal risk, or whether, in fact, it reflects that the fact that kids that may be suicidally prone may also be much more prone to using marijuana. On the other hand, this data here is actually quite factual vis-a-vis the evidence. What is driving these poor outcomes in teenagers when they smoke marijuana regularly? Well, one of the studies that has provoked a lot of interest is this one that came out from a prospective study in Dunedin that has followed 1,337 individuals from age 13 up to adulthood, in which they evaluated their consumption of marijuana during different stages of adolescence. And what this study showed was that when they control for IQ, actually before they get exposed to marijuana, those kids that actually were consuming marijuana throughout their adolescence have much lower values of IQ as compared to those that did not. In other words, the exposure to marijuana was associated with a significant decline in IQ, even when controlling for premorbid intelligence quotient. Why? Why is that marijuana does that? Why would it do that? Again, I know that I have the specific answers, but studies are starting to emerge that actually are focusing on the utilization, taking advantage of the utilization of imaging technologies, brain imaging technologies, to try to investigate how does the exposure to marijuana during adolescence influence the architecture of your brain. And this is important because we do know that cannabinoids receptors, the CB1 receptors, along with the endogenous cannabinoids, modulate synaptic formation and architecture connections in the brain, which is ultimately what the brain is about. The brain is a series of extraordinary complex networks. And this is one of these technologies. It uses diffusion tensor imaging with MRI to actually measure the density of connections, and they compare individuals that have been exposed to marijuana during adolescence versus those that were not exposed to marijuana during adolescence. And then they coded in color those connections where the two groups differ, and they showed a very dramatic reduction in the fibers that connect to this area of the brain called the precuneus, which happens to be one of the main hubs of our brain. This is a very area that is connected basically with the rest, extremely dense connections with the rest of the brain, therefore involved in the orchestrating functions and processes. And the other one where they saw a very significant reduction were connections into the hippocampus. And the hippocampus is an area of the brain involved with memory and learning and could provide you a mechanism about why. If it does, exposure to marijuana decreases the density of connectivity into the hippocampus. This, for example, could lead you to a disadvantage in your ability to memorize and learn, who could then translate as a decrease in your ability to perform in intelligence tests. So this is a study that indicates, that suggests, in fact, that yes, exposure to marijuana is deleterious to the formation, to the density connectivity of the brain. And in this study, they showed that the greater the younger that you start, again highlighting the importance of exposure in adolescence, the younger you start, the worse the connectivity, the lower the connectivity. And my final slide, again, to highlight the importance of actually exposure of marijuana to adolescents, relate to something that has been very, very controversial, that has generated a lot of interest, for which there is some evidence by some and not by others, which is, does marijuana exposure produce schizophrenia? And the answer is, we know that exposure to marijuana, particularly if you do it in adolescents, these are cannabis users by age 15, versus those that started after age 14, and this is the risk for developing a diagnosis of schizophrenia. Again, this is a prospective study, the Dunedin study. Your risk for schizophrenia are much higher. But the question is it a causal linkage by itself? As an alternative explanation in terms of what we now, most research seems to indicate, is that if you do have the vulnerability, as shown here, this is a gene associated with vulnerability for schizophrenia, this AKTCC, if you have this gene, you have a higher risk of schizophrenia, but only in those that are exposed to marijuana. Whereas if you have that gene that is at risk for schizophrenia, but you don't get exposed to marijuana, these investigators did not see any increased risk for the expression of marijuana, which led us to the sense that exposure to marijuana, particularly if you are very, very young and you have the genetic vulnerability or other factors that increase your vulnerability for psychosis and schizophrenia, the use of marijuana may trigger an event or may exacerbate it. And so those are all areas that deserve attention. And this is why NIDA, the main project, the main initiative in partnership with other NIH institutes, including the Alcohol Institute and the Child and Health Development, and the Cancer Institute because of their interest in tobacco, and the Mental Health Institute because of the association of drugs with mental illness, is proposing a large cohort study that will be evaluating periodically 10,000 children throughout the United States as they transition from childhood into adulthood using advanced brain imaging technologies, detailed phenotypic characterization, and behavioral measurements, such that we can have evidence, unequivocal evidence, that can help us delineate what are the effects of marijuana in the developing human brain, and what are factors that are associated with worse outcomes, and or whether, in fact, not in certain individuals, the exposure is not associated with harmful effect, and so therefore, what are the resilient factors that protecting these adolescents? Extremely urgent, as we made all of these decisions in really very little data, as states are deciding to implement legalization of marijuana without really preparing or anticipating that these changes are going to, in fact, increase the rate and exposure of teenagers to marijuana. And with that, I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you. And now for our second speaker, Dr. Daniele Piomelli, Professor of Anatomy and Neurobiology, Pharmacology and Biological Chemistry, and the Louise Turner Arnold Chair in the Neurosciences at the University of California, Irvine.
Thank you so much for having me here. My charge today is to talk to you about marijuana as a medicine. And I could start off by showing you some statistics, but I won't. I will share with you instead an email I received not long ago. And it reads as follows: Dear Dr. Piomelli, I have read about your work on marijuana. I am the father of a three-year-old girl diagnosed with autism. I would walk through fire to get her a cure. Can marijuana help my girl? So as a father, my blood curdles when I read this stuff. And I get literally hundreds of these emails every year. I'm sure Dr. Volkow gets as many, probably more. But as a scientist, I have to ask myself a different question, which is, beyond this cry for help that we hear from the public, what are the scientific questions that we can actually answer at this point in time? And I think there are three questions that we must answer, but I'll tell you right off the bat that we cannot answer them all right now. The first one is, what medical condition, if any, can benefit from marijuana use? The second is, what are the risks associated with its medicinal use, which are not necessarily the same as those associated with the recreational uses? And the third question is, what can marijuana teach us that may lead us to better therapies? And let us remind ourselves, with a little bit of modesty, that we may have personal answers to all these questions, but those are opinions. They're not factually based answers. We don't have evidence-based answers on all these questions. Actually, we have a very, very few of them. What is that we really know? So what I'd like in the next 10 minutes or so to share with you are some ideas, some facts, concerning two of these questions. The medical conditions in which we can use marijuana, And what marijuana can teach us about the brain, about the functioning of the central nervous system, that can lead us to better therapies. The reason why I'm not touching upon this question, what are the risks associated with the medicinal use of marijuana, is not because it's not an important question. It's simply because we don't know anything. We know a little bit about what is the recreational, the impact of recreational marijuana, as Dr. Volkow pointed out, but medicinal marijuana use is likely to be different. It's likely to be different in use, in dosages, it's likely to be different in route of administration. So we need to really reassess based on what the use will be. So here is the plant, and here is really the chemical compound in the plant that is responsible for most of what we call the psychotropic effects of marijuana, that is its ability to give us a high, make us stoned. The way it works, as Dr. Volkow pointed out, is by interacting with a protein present on the surface of our neural cells and also elsewhere in the body. And this protein is called cannabinoid receptor. It's a protein that binds, recognizes delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, THC, changes shape and influences the activity of the cell on which it is housed. And what does this cause? In turn, it causes a variety of effects. It changes our eating, as you well know. The munchies are famous, one of the famous side effects of marijuana. It changes emotion, mood, anxiety. It changes our response to pain. And the rewarding systems of the brain that Dr. Volkow has described before briefly for us, leading to addiction. Again, I'd like to stress marijuana is an addictive drug. And it changes memory. All those are things that cannabinoid receptors regulate in the brain that are affected in different ways when users take the drug in. But these are the physiological, the pharmacological effects. What are clinically the medical conditions for which THC in marijuana can be beneficial? One fact that we must remember is that THC is already a drug. It's an FDA-approved drug for use to reduce nausea and stimulate eating in cancer patients and in HIV patients undergoing chemotherapy. So it's already an approved Schedule 3 drug. But what else can marijuana and THC help us with? Well, there are very, very few data out there. So what I will show you is one example of what I consider to be one of the most documented cases. And I'm sorry, you cannot read it very well here. It reads chronic neuropathic pain. And chronic neuropathic pain is a condition arising from damage to the nervous system, to nerves, that affects 1 in 10 Americans. And THC can alleviate chronic neuropathic pain by engaging with cannabinoid receptors in the brain and the spinal cord. And here is one study which I consider very well performed. It was done by Dr. Donald Abrams at UCSF, in which the group looked at pain intensity as a reported score in patients with various forms of neuropathy. And what you can see here are, and I'm sorry, this reads placebo under the clock, and this is marijuana. So these are people taking, subjects taking either placebo or marijuana, and this is when the first cigarette is taken, and this is where the last cigarette is taken. And if you look at the placebo effect, this being pain intensity, is, you know, there is clearly an effect, but it's very modest, and then the levels of pain perception go back to they were before. And subjects taking marijuana instead experience a much stronger analgesia. Now, other studies have confirmed this. There are at least 2 or 3 studies that have confirmed this. There are studies that have not confirmed this. There is one study out of Germany showing that pure THC also appears to be moderately effective in neuropathic pain, although its actions are accompanied by a greater, larger number of side effects than those of smoked marijuana. And this is not magic. It's just because when one smokes marijuana, can titrate, can better determine the amount of marijuana that will be useful to get him or her to reduce the symptoms. Whereas if you take a pill, once you've taken the pill, there is nothing else you can do, all right? So these are data, and they are supportive of, they're promising, but they need to be confirmed. There are also data on other conditions, and I'll briefly mention those that in the literature I found to be believable. Inflammatory bowel disease, where marijuana has been tested. Multiple sclerosis, the symptoms of multiple sclerosis, particularly the well-being of the patient, where a compound, a drug called Sativex, which is really a marijuana extract, has been tested with some success. Anxiety disorders, where purified THC has been tested, something called Marinol. This is the FDA-approved drug. And these are old studies that need to be confirmed. And studies out of Germany showing that Marinol, again, is effective in Tourette syndrome, a well-known disease to many of you because it's been publicized a lot recently, by even by a movie. And importantly, cannabis use disorder itself, which is, you know, the dependence and addiction caused by marijuana, can be alleviated by the use of Marinol. This is studies out of Columbia University. Now, these are all promising data. However, they are preliminary, and additional studies are needed in order to be confirmed. Now, I talked about THC. There is something else in marijuana. There are 80 other compounds of the same chemical structure, plus hundreds of other chemicals. One of them has attracted a lot of attention. I get a lot of emails about that one. It's called cannabidiol. Here is the structure. And cannabidiol also acts on the brain, but really, we don't know how. We don't have a receptor. We don't know. It binds to many, many things, which usually means that it binds to nothing. So we have to know, we have to really learn more about cannabidiol. What we have done a few years ago, collaborating with a group in Germany, we have looked at its action in schizophrenia. And let me remind you that 1 in 100 people suffer from this disease. And it's really debilitating mental disorder. And here are the data collected in this double-blinded study in which cannabidiol in blue was compared not to placebo, this is not a placebo-controlled study, but was compared to amisulpiride, which is a standard antipsychotic agent, a D2 dopamine antagonist, dopamine blocker. And these are looking at disease symptoms, the so-called PANS, positive and negative symptoms of schizophrenia, where positive and negative refers to the florid hallucinations that accompany the disease and to the social withdrawal that is also a consequence of the disease. And as you can see, cannabidiol is quite effective, as effective as amisulpiride is, possibly even better. But I think the kicker really is here to the right, where Marcus Leveke, who led the clinical group here, showed that the side effects of cannabidiol were really minor compared to the side effects of amisulpiride. Now, amisulpiride is a standard antipsychotic compound, so it causes these Parkinsonian-like syndromes called extrapyramidal syndromes. There are newer drugs that don't cause those symptoms, but they have other side effects. But as you can see, at least in this comparison, CBD did very well. So this covers pretty much what I wanted to tell you about the what we think, what we know about really marijuana as a medicine. And if it looks very little, it's because we do know very little. But we have learned a lot in the last 20 years about what marijuana does in the brain by studying the endogenous system that marijuana hijacks. Obviously, the fact that there are cannabinoid receptors in the brain, it doesn't mean that evolution has put them there to bind, to recognize pot so that we could enjoy pot when we smoke it, if we smoke it. I mean, our friends smoke it. I mean, I forgot I was in D.C. But the endogenous system that binds these receptors is actually driven by these two compounds, anandamide and 2-arachidonyl glycerol, which are bona fide neurotransmitters that have, just like cannabinoid receptors, all those effects that we discussed briefly before, feeling, emotion, pain, memory, and reward. So I'd like to give you, in closing, one example of situation where this could be leveraged to use to create new medicines, better and safer and more effective medicines. And this comes from a work that we have done and we haven't really published yet, in social behavior. By the way, these compounds are called, these endogenous ligands, these endogenous marijuana-like molecules are called endocannabinoids. And we looked at their role in social behavior because people take marijuana really as a social drug. So we were interested in understanding how the endogenous system might be involved in regulating sociality. And the experiment we started off with was very, very simple. We took some mice. This is an animal study. We socialized them, so we put them in their normal group. These are mice like rats and us live in societies. They're called deems, and they kind of like being there. They don't like to be on their own, and we kept some isolated and some socialized. And then we took their brains. We macrodissected out a tiny region of the brain called the nucleus accumbens, which is the region of the brain where actually a lot of the reward processing occurs. And we measured anandamide levels in this particular region. And as you can see here, isolated mice have very low anandamide levels, but if you put them in a social context, their levels triple. What does this mean? Of course, we cannot tell based on this data, but what we can do, we can run some pharmacological experiment and genetic experiments. And we can do two things. We can block anandamide. In other terms, we can prevent anandamide from acting by, for example, blocking the receptor, cannabinoreceptor for anandamide. And what we discover is that if we block anandamide, the mice prefer being alone. On the other hand, if we boost anandamide, and we can do that with drugs that block the degradation of anandamide, so anandamide normally is destroyed, but we give a chemical that stops its destruction, then the levels of anandamide rise, and the animals now prefer company. Now, this obviously opens a window, I think, into our understanding of what the endocannabinoid system and anandamide in particular does in social behavior. Possibly it explains why some people really need marijuana to feel social, just like, you know, you need also alcohol sometimes to feel social. But I think more importantly, it suggests that drugs that boost the prosocial effects of marijuana, of anandamide, may be used in disorders in which our social nature, which is so profoundly ours, is really what characterizes us as humans, is undermined. And these are autism conditions such as autism and schizophrenia. There is, of course, much more, but I'd like to stop with three statements. I think that in the next 5 years, not in the next 50 years, in the next 5 years, there are three things that we can do. We can say the last word on marijuana's effectiveness in a number of medical indications. Not in all of them, but in a few select ones in 5 years, we can say, yes, it works, no, it doesn't work. We need to be wanting to do it. The second thing is that during the same time, if we organize ourselves, we can actually assess the risks associated with medicinal marijuana use, not exactly the same as those involved in recreational use. And finally, and that closest to my heart, if we work hard, we can leverage, and we are lucky, we can leverage our growing knowledge of the endocannabinoid system to make better medicines for a variety of conditions. I talked about autism and schizophrenia, but there is also pain, there is also glaucoma, there is also epilepsy. These are all conditions that are very, very important, but more speculative, I think, than pain, autism, and schizophrenia. And with this, I'll stop, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Our third speaker is Dr. Rosalie Pacula. She's director of the Big Center for Health Economics and co-director of the Drug Policy Research Center at the RAND Corporation.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this opportunity to speak with you. I'm going to be taking us from the world of the brain to a broader social unit of social communities. I was asked to talk a little bit about marijuana policy and what do we know from the science that we learned thus far in terms of its impacts. In the case of medical marijuana, I'm going to use an example of what we're learning right now from medical marijuana laws. This is only one area in which we could talk about marijuana policy. There's lots of other policies out there, and I'm happy to discuss those as well. But I think it's useful to focus here on just medical marijuana policy to demonstrate two key points that are true for evaluating any marijuana policy. And that is, one, not all medical marijuana policies or other marijuana policies are the same. There's heterogeneity in those laws, what they do, who they provide access to, for what. And those details have important implications regarding both access and potential harms. Secondly, if we're going to think about the effects of these laws, I won't be focusing on the effects to patients because we don't have very good data yet on all patients. It's not a requirement that medical patients register and that we track them. It's true for some states that they're required, but not for all states. So we don't know enough to say what the impacts of these laws are on medical marijuana patients themselves, their conditions, and their potential benefits. So I will be focusing more on the implications for recreational use, which is one of the concerns about these policies. It's widely well known in the newspapers nearly weekly that there are at least 24 states now with Georgia and the District of Columbia that have medical marijuana laws. What's less well known is that there's actually far more than that, 11 more states here identified in yellow that allow for marijuana-based extracts to be used for very specific medical conditions, basically cannabidiol, which was mentioned before, being used for specific conditions like seizures and epilepsy. But those state laws aren't widely recognized and heralded as evidence of medical marijuana laws. I mean, if you look at this map, all of a sudden you realize that two-thirds of the states have recognized the therapeutic benefit of particular extracts of the cannabis plant. That's not what we hear by policy advocates who focus more on just the blue states. And the reason is why. We need to start with what is a definition of medical marijuana, what do we mean by it, in order to evaluate the implications of the policy. So I'm going to start here with the early definition, because those 11 yellow states, the cannabidiol-only states, where extracts very high in CBD, which are targeting certain areas of the brain, are allowed, but those states also only allow very little amount of THC in the cannabis that's used for medicinal purposes, less than 3%. I'm not going to focus on those laws because those were relatively new and passed just last year, 2014, 11 states passed that, and we don't have good science on them yet. I'm going to be focusing on the earlier laws where medical marijuana is basically defined as a policy that's aimed at trying to provide access for possession, use, cultivation, and distribution for specific medicinal conditions. The laws as they're written, like I emphasized earlier, are quite heterogeneous. They're detailed in terms of who they define as patients. Some states allow for patients under the age of 21, others do not. The medical conditions for which they allow medicinal marijuana varies quite a bit across states. Who gets defined as a caregiver differs in these laws. In some cases, it's a relationship between an individual and somebody who can take care of them in their daily living, which it makes a lot of sense for a cancer patient or somebody suffering in the final stages of HIV. But it's rarely the doctor that's identified as the caregiver, which is important to think about when you think about these policies. Definition of marijuana in the blue law states is quite broad, relying to as much of the plant as the seed, as well as the extracts contained within the marijuana. As was mentioned previously, there's already over 80 different cannabinoids represented in the cannabis plant and over 100 strands of marijuana available. So when we talk about medical marijuana as medicine, we're talking about 100 different products. We're not talking about Sativex from GW Pharmaceutical, where the precise chemical makeup is well known and well established. That's important for interpreting the impacts of these policies because we aren't talking about a homogeneous product. We're talking about multiple products, so it's going to be hard to get precise science on multiple products. Quantities are always specified, as well as the source of supply, which is a growing aspect of these policies, as we've learned, as the states have learned, how to provide access to patients in a way that the federal government will not crack down, because under current system, it's still illegal to use marijuana, even for medicinal purposes, given the current scheduling of marijuana. What this graph shows is that the rise in bars of the number of states that have adopted medical marijuana policies, again, focusing on the blue law states, through 2013, starting in California. In 2013, we had 19 states that had recognized medical marijuana laws, and you can see the number of registered patients has been growing with this to the point that in 2013 there were over 1 million registered patients using marijuana for medicinal purposes. That sounds like a very big number. It's less than 5% of the US, a half a percent of the US population in 2013. What's important to know is that there's kind of steps in these evolution of this policy that are really important for understanding the science of what we learned from them so far. The initial laws that were passed in the late 1990s up until Hawaii passed its law in 2000 were largely passed through ballot initiatives. These are well-intended people who wanted to provide medicine for people who had very chronic conditions, but needed to do so in a way where they didn't get in trouble with the federal government. So the laws were very broad. They were largely providing legal protection to the patients and in a couple cases their caregivers. The primary source of how to get it was either not specified at law, in the law at all, or they said, okay, you can grow. And they were varied in terms of the number of plants that they allowed to grow. States were using this approach, again, because of concerns of how the federal government might respond to state policy in this regard. As they saw that the federal government was largely not cracking down on states, say Oregon, which had this policy but didn't allow up to 100 plants to be grown for medicinal purposes, they were cracking down in California, where some caregivers were growing 100 plants. States started learning that, oh, there's lines that we can stay under that will help allow us to make it available for patients. And states started passing these laws through legislative processes in phase two. Hawaii was the first to pass a law through a legislative process, and as such has a lot more detail at trying to differentiate who is a medical user and who is a recreational user pretending to be a medical user, providing law enforcement clear guidelines on who and how they should be enforcing the policies for and against. The phase two laws were much more careful to include patient registries, so law enforcement had a quick way of identifying who had a legitimate medical use and who did not. They also allowed for more limited cultivation. They didn't say grow as much as you want or if you think you need, grow up to three mature plants, 6 to 7 other plants. And they also started providing protections more explicitly to caregivers. This obviously led to an increase in the number of states. More states started passing these policies, as well as the number of patients, until October 2009, when the Assistant Attorney General Ogden produced a memo stating that the federal government would not waste its limited enforcement resources targeting legitimate patients who are in direct compliance, clear and direct compliance with their state policies for medicinal use. That opened the door for states to become much more detailed in terms of how and what they would devise as their medical marijuana system. Dispensary systems became much more common because they could be regulated and monitored by the states. California was the first to adopt a dispensary system legally protected in 2003. There was New Mexico that adopted in 2007. It's really the floodgates, including Colorado, that provided legal protection for dispensaries starting in 2009 when this Ogden memo came out and said, look, we're going to let you do what you're doing, experiment as long as this is for medicinal purposes. The evolution of this law is very, very important when you're thinking about the science and what the implications are. Different types of marijuana policies are believed to influence recreational use for different reasons. I will focus now just on medical for the purposes of this discussion, but in the case of medical marijuana, the direct effect of this policy is a reduction in the perceived harm for marijuana, because now marijuana is being seen as a medicine. It's not just bad and bad for the brain and development, it actually has some beneficial effects. There's a direct effect on legal risk of using, because certain people are legally allowed to get it, and they can either buy it at a shop or they can grow it at home, and so the risk of using it have dropped dramatically, and because of that, there's an increase in access. Indirectly, this policy has also been identified as influencing changes in disapproval of marijuana for recreational purposes, because people become more aware of other people seeing beneficial effects of the policy. And more important to me as an economist, impacts on the relative price of the drug, because as the risks of using have fallen, as a legitimate supply chain has emerged, the price of marijuana has fallen dramatically. So we do expect that even medical marijuana systems that are designed to provide marijuana for a strict group of medicinal users actually has the potential to have effects on the non-medical market. And so early studies that tried to look at this looked at the early phases of the law and generally saw, particularly for youth, that there was no effect of these early medical marijuana laws on prevalence of 30-day use of marijuana. And if anything, what they found was that there was actually a real benefit because they saw less alcohol use in states reported among youth in states that adopted these medicinal marijuana laws. And it looks like, wow, medical marijuana might really be a very good thing if it doesn't have this negative bleed effect on youth in particular and on adults as well. The problem is the early studies were limited in two particular ways. The focus of the research was largely on 30-day prevalence rates, which I show here. You saw a very similar side of this in Dr. Volkow's presentation. This is self-reported past month prevalence among 8th grade, 10th grade, and 12th grade students in the Monitoring the Future survey. Basically not much change in 30-day prevalence of marijuana use. But what that masks is what's going on with daily use of marijuana. And when you look at daily use of marijuana among teens, there's been dramatic changes, and this is also true for adults. So while 30-day prevalence use in the past 3 days might not be changing, we might not be influencing some of these marginal experimenter users, we are influencing kids who are already actively involved in more regular harmful use of the substance. The second problem with the studies that were done so far is they assumed all medical marijuana laws are the same. Phase one laws are the same as phase two laws. Phase two laws are the same as phase three laws, and these are not the same regulatory systems. They differ in very important ways, and even early adopting states, such as California, where I'm from, had a number of significant changes in its medical marijuana policy over time, and those changes influence access, price, perceived harm, and the mechanisms that I already mentioned to you. States that provide legal protections of dispensaries, and we've seen this clearly in Colorado as well as California, allow for almost a commercialization of them when they are done without tight monitoring. That can have differential effects than, say, a dispensary system in New Mexico or the one that's proposed in Massachusetts, where it's limited in terms of the types of products, it's very highly regulated, and there's limited advertising of them. Home cultivation has changed dramatically in these laws and over time in terms of the number of plants and the number of patients who are allowed to grow. And then finally, patient registries. Patient registries actually serve as a deterrent for diversion into the non-medical market. Patients who register provide themselves legal protection, but they also could be identified, unfortunately, by federal prosecutors if they chose to do so. So in some states that didn't require registry, again, it made it very gray for law enforcement. They had the legal right, but they had no way of proving they were a patient. In other states that required a patient registry, law enforcement knew from day one who had the right to use and knew how to differentiate their enforcement, and it actually has less of an effect on use. When we look at studies, a lot of this work is work that a team of researchers with me at RAND Corporation has been doing with funding from the National Institute of Drug Abuse, as well as other researchers I'm citing here. A recent study in the Journal of Health Economics by a group of National Bureau of Economic researchers looking at data from the National Survey of Drug Use or Health. The findings, when you look at the existence of any medical marijuana law, the zero simple 01, a state has a medical marijuana law or it doesn't, are generally consistent with the early messages of these policies. There's either no significant effect of medical marijuana laws on the range of youth outcomes, marijuana initiation, 30-day prevalence of use, annual treatment admissions, or alcohol-related harms, it might actually be beneficial. When you look at the aspects of the policies, though, and the specific allowances for certain types of things, in particular I'm showing here protection for legal dispensaries, those benefits of just having a medical marijuana law change. And in fact, what we find is legally protected medical dispensaries are actually associated with more use 30-day, more treatment admissions, and more alcohol use and accidents associated with alcohol-related fatalities in the cars, even for youth. The one exception is opioids. In the case of youth, we don't have a significant relationship there for either the policy or legal dispensaries, but when we look at adults, we see the same general tendency. So what looks like a relatively innocuous policy of medical marijuana, allow states to adopt medical marijuana laws, doesn't have a whole lot of negative outcomes. In fact, it might actually be beneficial. when you look at legal dispensaries in particular, a particular aspect of these laws, and this is looking at early laws, I need to emphasize this, these are early regulated dispensaries. This is not, most of these studies have not been able to do a careful evaluation of dispensary systems that have been adopted since 2010, because the research designs don't allow it. So what we're seeing right now for the early adopting states may not hold true for the later dispensary systems that are more tightly regulated. But it has important implications for legalization policy, because legalization policy is about providing retail access, which is what these early dispensaries were doing for medical patients. Here I highlight some other aspects of the medical marijuana laws, in this case, marijuana use on treatment admissions youth use, 30-day prevalence. You can see just looking at having any medical marijuana law, the blue bars, generally a negative effect. If you're looking at dispensaries, the green bar, even on 30-day prevalence, there's a positive effect of marijuana use, even a bigger effect on home cultivation if we're looking at days of marijuana use. So the key takeaway from this slide, and then finally marijuana treatment emissions, the key takeaway from this slide is that different aspects of medical marijuana policies differentially influence different types of medical marijuana use. This is not medical, this is recreational marijuana use. And so the type of policy that's adopted matters. And it might not matter so much for 30-day prevalence. That's not what we care about if we're thinking about reinforcement in the brain. We care more about the number of days of use and heavy use requiring treatment. This is showing similar results, in this case, for alcohol use, where, again, we have 30-day use among youth, 30-day use in a different population of youth, and then treatment admissions. And again, you'll see a differential effects of particular aspects of the policy. So the key takeaways here is that when evaluating and assessing the impact of these policies, first you want to be careful of what measure of use is being examined. You can tell a nice, simple story if you're looking at composite measures of past year use, past month use, but that might not be what we care most about, particularly if we're talking about kids. We might care more about frequency use, frequency of daily use, and risks of abuse of dependence. Secondly, I hope you've heard me say many times, all medical marijuana laws are not alike. It's absolutely true when we think about alcohol structure, the designing of a regulatory system for alcohol structure, and I don't think anybody would argue that blue law states are very, very different than other states for alcohol that allow for a regular sale even on Sundays and in a store, and you don't have to go to a certain specific store to buy liquor. That's true about marijuana, but we haven't been thinking of those in that regard when we talk about medical marijuana or even legal marijuana. We're talking about it as if it's a single commodity and we just are legalizing. There's lots of different varieties of legalizing this substance. And in a report that we just recently did for the state of Vermont, we provided them with a very detailed assessment of a range, 8 different alternatives of regulatory systems that could exist to legally make marijuana available. They have very different implications in terms of the potential harms and leakages to youth in particular. And with that, I'd like to open it up for comments and questions.
Great, now we'll bring all the speakers up to our panel table for Q&A.
My name is Howard Wolbridge, retired police detective and representing LEAP, Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. The two doctors, Dr. Volkow, we all know we need more research on this issue. The AMA in 2001 said, let's have some serious research so we can answer once and for all whether marijuana is effective medicine or not. What I want to make sure you're aware of is 25 years ago, under the Bush 41 administration, 13 citizens were chosen for an experiment to see what would happen when they were given large amounts of marijuana. They received upwards of 300 joints per month off the farm in Mississippi. I believe there's still 4 that are alive. And yet, during these 25 years, the federal government, NIDA, I would soon be the primary agency, has never brought these patients in to test them for the long-term, extremely heavy use of marijuana. Is this something you're aware of? And are you allowed under law to bring these patients in to test them, to do the research? And would you do that if you are allowed?
Yeah, this is actually an interesting question. And yes, definitely, I'm very aware that we provide marijuana through the contract at the University of Mississippi. I've been providing it for many, many years for patients that require the use of marijuana based on their physicians. We don't actually ourselves do the research. What we do is we fund grants from investigators that want to do the research. So say, for example, that you said, wouldn't it be an incredible opportunity to evaluate how in these patients the exposure to marijuana for such a long period of time has affected their disease condition or other parameters? You write a grant and you apply for NIDA. And if it is scientifically reviewed properly, the grant gets funded and you do the study. So that's the way that we operate as an agency. So yes, and yes, absolutely, we are allowed to do studies of science. That's what we're funded for.
I'd like to follow up to that question because to my understanding, NIDA does not make marijuana available to academic researchers or scientific researchers to examine the medical efficacy of marijuana. Can you tell me when the last time was that NIDA gave out a grant to do research on the medical efficacy of marijuana?
Yes, indeed. I mean, it is actually, NIDA provides the marijuana that's required for investigators that actually are interested on evaluating the potential beneficial effects of marijuana. We recently, I think that the most recent one was a study that we did in partnership with the National Institute of Neurological Diseases in order to study the effects of cannabidiol for epilepsy. In anticipation also of the increased interest that the public has on the potential of marijuana and the importance of doing the research, because I agree completely with Dr. Piomelli, we need to understand the extent for which conditions marijuana may have some benefit and in which conditions they not, which are the patients that may be most likely to respond. So we increase the amount of marijuana that we produce in the a farm of Mississippi dramatically in anticipating that we will be getting more grant requests to look at these type of questions. So it's not correct that NIDA does not provide. In fact, it's the only source. Currently, there is a law that basically requires that if you are going to do a research on the value of marijuana for a medical purpose, that NIDA provides that marijuana. So that's a law. We didn't create it. We just have to abide for it.
Do you mind if I add just the researcher's perspective on this? The main hurdles that we have are not so much in getting the marijuana, but in going through the process, the bureaucratic process of getting a permission to use a Schedule I drug. Let me remind you that Schedule I drugs are drugs that are harmful and addictive. They are not helpful and they're addictive. So marijuana as a plant is listed in Schedule I, not as an active compound, which means every single component of marijuana, including cannabidiol, is listed in Schedule I. So anybody who wants to do studies on cannabidiol, on cannabichromene, or anything that is in there, has to obtain a Schedule I permission. Now, I have that once, and it was hellish. Then when I changed the institution, the University of California has different laws, different regulations, so I never got one. So I am a marijuana researcher who cannot use THC. And that's a problem.
Yeah, and I think that I'll agree with you, and I think that that is an aspect that we've been working very closely with the FDA and the DEA to try to address what are the issues that are making it harder for researchers to do studies on marijuana. As an agency, we're a scientific agency. We don't necessarily determine when something is we don't determine when something is Schedule I or Schedule II or Schedule or non-Schedule. So. But you are right. I mean, the need for a registration license is actually very takes time and it's a lengthy process.
If I could add one more, Dr. El Soli, who is the lead investigator at the University of Mississippi who grows the marijuana under the funds provided by National Institute of Drug Abuse, has been very actively preparing for these requests to use it and actually is growing different strains of marijuana so that we can understand how different mixes of cannabinoids in the plant could be useful for medicinal purposes, and that's with funding from NIDA. So it's important to understand the difference between the funding agency that to do the research and then the other barriers to doing the research.
I guess recognizing that the closest thing to consensus on marijuana research is that there are difficulties and barriers that exist. Are there changes that you might recommend Congress consider to reduce those barriers and encourage further research?
That exactly what you're doing right now here and listening to the input from various constituents actually to try to determine what may be something that you all can do to facilitate research is an important first step. And there are, and I think that's again something that you all need to discuss, what would be changes or suggestions that could make research on marijuana easier to do. And I want to also, though, very particularly in my brain, I think would be very, very helpful is to be able to have access to cannabidiol because for research in a much easier way than it's currently, because cannabidiol is not differentiated, it's considered marijuana, so it's very, very difficult, again, to do research. And there is some very interesting data to suggest that it may have opportunities for therapeutic applications.
If I may add to just one thing, thank you so much, Nora. That's exactly my thoughts. But also, I think very simply, taking marijuana off Schedule 1 makes sense. Keeping it there makes no sense. And, you know, the Washington Post asked me 10 years ago to write an op-ed on this, which was titled, "This Drug is on the Wrong List." And, you know, 10 years have passed and the drug is still on the wrong list. So hopefully maybe one day it will come off the wrong list. Let me remind you, THC is also scheduled, but it's Schedule 3, okay? So I think that's where it belongs. Cannabidiol, cannabichromium, cannabinol, and all the other cannabinoid chemical compounds have a name, cannabinol. It sounds bad, but it isn't. Those compounds have no activity on the brain whatsoever.
Dr. Volkow, you mentioned that NIDA has a monopoly on the supply of marijuana that can be used for research purposes. Given that it's the National Institute on Drug Abuse and that its statutory mission is to study the causes and consequences of drug abuse and addiction, would it be appropriate perhaps to have marijuana available to researchers through other channels if they're interested in looking at the medical benefits rather than simply abuse and addiction? And I guess linked to that, most of the people who use medical marijuana in this country obtain it from a dispensary in Colorado or California or other states. So why would it not perhaps be appropriate, if we really want to learn the effects of this, to allow researchers and scientists to do research using the forms of marijuana that people use, hundreds of thousands of millions of Americans every day use those medications through dispensaries. Why not allow researchers to do research using those substances rather than having to obtain marijuana in Mississippi, which is often much different?
Yeah, no, and you're touching on something that we're also very sensitive, because we increased our quota from 20 basically kilograms to 600 kilograms of production of marijuana to anticipate research on medical purposes. But my concern is that, for example, you come to me and says, well, I want to have a cigarette that has cannabidiol, and we prepare and do the plants and give you the cannabidiol. But then I have five other investigators that need a different variety. I need to start from scratch to create those cigarettes if I have not anticipated and created them beforehand. So it's a system that is lengthy and cumbersome, and in a way not the most effective one. So the question is, why is it this way? There is a law. And as an agency, we abide by the law, and this relates to regulations that were not thought by us as scientists, but that pertain to treaties across nations. So that's why we have the monopoly of marijuana for research purposes. Scientifically, does it need to be that way? Scientifically, it needs not be that way. And in fact, it would make, I think, the distribution much more efficient, provided that there was a way to ensure that the products that were going to be given to the researcher do have the characteristics that they state they have, which could be regulated like we regulate for other things.
If I could add to that, I mean, the primary limit when research gets funded, it has to be scientifically evaluated. There's not a chemical out there that doesn't get explored for medicinal purposes where the exact dose of the active ingredient isn't known and well known in terms of the delivery, how much is going to be taken by the body and over what period of time. In the case of these 100 different strands of marijuana, in some states there's testing, but in very few places is it required that every ingredient in the plant be on a label. And so a scientist going into a dispensary trying to buy certain strands for research purposes isn't going to get past a review committee because they don't know what exactly is in that plant. Until we have active testing of all the chemicals that are being sold in dispensaries, a scientific review committee isn't going to be willing to waste resources on an unknown product, because it could be that THC or CBD is more responsive when there's other cannabinoids present at the same time, and it's the amalgamation. And if we don't know the actual levels of all of them scientifically, we wouldn't know if it's what we're studying or it's just a side effect of what else is in the plant. So it would help science if the dispensaries much more proactively provided detailed ingredients so researchers could then get scientifically approved research done on the different strands.
If I may add something to this, that's a very, very important point. The heterogeneity that we are experiencing is really very confusing to many of us, to the public for sure, but even for us who are researchers, and can result in serious consequences. I was appalled by learning that CBD only states allow what, 3% minimum, maximum THC? Yeah. Now, this seems like very little, but let me tell you, 3% THC is actually a lot. That is not as much as what we find now in commercially sold marijuana, but in the 70s was about, you know, the percentage of THC was about between 2-3%, and it's certainly enough to cause substantial psychotropic actions. So the confusion is such that it can lead to erroneous policy decisions.
If I can simplify, here's the example I like to give. We're going to study the effects of a kid drinking alcohol. Do you want to know if they're drinking low-content beer, malt, vodka, absolute, whatever they're drinking? If you're going to evaluate the effects of the alcohol, you need to know how much ethanol they're consuming. And so that's the stage that we're at in understanding the effects of cannabis.
I'm just curious about some of the contradictions in the scheduling process. So you say that THC has been approved as a Schedule 3, yet, you know, cannabis itself, marijuana itself, still is ranked as a Schedule 1. Correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't part of the definition of the Schedule 1 state that it has no medicinal use? So, you know, if there's a contradiction there, is that just because they're able to isolate the one cannabinoid out from the rest? And if so, how does that not, you know, turn around and say, well, some of it has medical use, so therefore shouldn't all of it be removed from that classification? You know, can you clarify that in any way?
Yes, and we've been working with the FDA to try to actually understand exactly what the scheduling is all about. And what happens is that the THC has been Schedule 3 because it was approved as a medicine, so it was synthesized. It's synthetic. It wasn't extracted from the marijuana, and it was approved for a specific indication, and that's what they removed it, even though THC is in the marijuana plant. And so we have argued the same thing. Why can we not then make cannabidiol out of the Schedule 1? But as of now, their basically discussion is they treat all of the marijuana as a product. And therefore, it becomes very difficult if you don't apply. They have what they call 8-factor analysis, by which they determine if a substance should be moved out of Schedule 1 or put in another schedule. And based on that 8-factor analysis, their definition states that marijuana, even though 9-THC, THC has analgesic effects, cannot be removed, or anti-nausea effect cannot be removed from Schedule 1. But this is something that the FDA and the DEA asked the FDA to do the analysis, and therefore they do the analysis and they come up with a recommendation. Anyone of you, I think, can ask for the DEA to do a reconsideration. And my understanding is also that Congress can ask the DEA to change a scheduling of a drug. So there are different ways that drugs ultimately get scheduled.
Just a clarification on a semantics issue that always arises as to the difference between THC and synthetic THC. There is no difference, no difference, no difference. Synthetic THC is prepared in the lab and is pure. Plant-derived THC is prepared in the lab from the plant and is pure. That's it. So please, if even if you failed Science 101, to remember this.
but unfortunately, I mean, I think that scientific argument doesn't necessarily translate exactly into the way things are dealt with. So that is what we're, and many of these aspects are legal, and so it's not just. What I've learned all along is that science is not necessarily the king of the, that makes the final decisions. There are many other aspects that go.
I noticed that.
Yeah. Several times in the past, congressmen have asked heads of the DEA and other agencies, what is the relative danger of marijuana versus heroin or marijuana versus alcohol, et cetera? As I understand it, NIDA has never, no other federal agency, has ever put out a list of what are the most dangerous drugs available in America by whatever criteria that agency would determine would be appropriate. Are you aware that in 2010, the British folks did that in The Lancet, it was published 5 years ago, a list of the 20 most dangerous drugs available. No surprise to this police officer, alcohol was, of course, the most dangerous drug by far. More than tobacco, heroin, et cetera, for all the effects of that. Marijuana was number 8. Would it not be appropriate to help out legislators here? Because we live in an alcohol awareness society, and people can understand pretty much what 3 beers will do to you, or 13 beers, to help legislators, the congressmen, the senators, by giving them a list of the relative level of danger for all the, you know, say 20 odd drugs available in the United States. Is this something that NIDA could put together to help congressmen understand better where it is? We heard the president, you know, say, well, marijuana is no more dangerous than alcohol. And some people came off the rail saying, oh, it's worse. But we have no scientific list from experts like yourself. What is the most dangerous drug available in America, whether legal or illegal?
You know, and I obviously, I mean, we all think very much in that, and I gave you some data as it relates to the comparison of drugs with respect to its addictiveness, where you come up that nicotine has very, very high levels. So that's where the issue becomes difficult. The paper done by the British was they were asking physicians and scientists their subjective perception of what actually was more dangerous. And again, that depends with which the eye that you're looking at. So if you look at it in terms of mortality, the most dangerous drugs, just in terms of people that die associated with the drug, the number one is tobacco, 400,000 Americans. But if you look at it in terms of actually most people when they get cancer or pulmonary disease, they are in over 50 or 60 years of age. But then if you ask the question, which one is the most deleterious for young people, that you realize, for example, that the number one cause of death in young people is the car accidents with alcohol. Now, alcohol is a legal drug, and as a result of that, a lot of teenagers get exposed to it, and that accounts for very, very negative effects. So if you ask, for example, in terms of marijuana, does marijuana produce motor incoordination? Indeed, and in fact, use of marijuana is associated with motor accidents and fatal motor accidents. Is it as frequently associated as alcohol? No, it's less associated than alcohol. Now, does that mean that alcohol is more dangerous than marijuana? Perhaps, though we need to find out the moment that we start to legalize and make it equally accessible and frequently used. So these are difficult questions. As it relates, for example, in adolescence, and I always say that, cognitive development, brain development, nicotine, as far as we know, is not harmful to your brain developmental stages, and it does not impair cognition. Marijuana does. So that's why it's not a black and white answer on the one hand. And the other aspect that is too very important, why you have to be cautious on the way that you present this information. While I do see value, but you have to be cautious, is each one of us has unique vulnerabilities. So there are people that can smoke until they're 110 years old and they never get cancer from cigarettes, whereas there are others that with 10-year exposure will. So it's the same sort of things with drug, and this is what now is identified as the Precision Medicine Initiative, to try to understand how our genes in each one of us can make us vulnerable to particular harmful effects of one thing or the other, and that pertains the same thing for drugs.
Last question.
I also agree with that statement. We don't have much time to discuss these issues, but that's why I didn't go into that. That, I mean, as is, a lot of kids get exposed to marijuana, whether it's legal or non-legal. And that's what people say, well, what difference will it make? And the difference that it will make is actually the regularity with which they are going to get exposed to it. And so the point that a big concern is not just that you experiment, because 114 million Americans have experimented with marijuana already without all of the states being legal, but actually the transition into the regular patterns of use that become much more likely if the drug is easily accessible. And that's where the main concern emerges, that you're much more likely to see adverse effects of drugs when you use them regularly, and that applies for marijuana, alcohol, tobacco, whatever you want, you are looking at.
Yeah, I agree with that entirely. I think the point that I was trying to make is that these policy decisions often get made as a 0-1 decision, prohibition or legalization. And the point that much of our research has tried to demonstrate is that it's not a 0-1 decision. There's lots of variants of the policy in between. And those variants in those policies have different implications regarding the risk of youth having access or potential for abuse. We know from the alcohol and tobacco regulatory systems that some structures are better at reducing access than others are, and we can learn from that experience, and we shouldn't just sit there. And it's nice to have conversations when we talk to policymakers now, when we say, our voters are talking about legalization, and we say, legalization how? And they actually know what we mean, because they're thinking about it, yeah, do we want to have a limited set of retail shops with limited licenses? Do we want to have it as a nonprofit organization? What's the structure that we want to do versus just full-scale legalization without any sort of understood regular structure? And of course, the current federal government and this current administration is allowing that flexibility to some degree in these administrative memos where they're saying we're not going to enforce when individuals are operating within their specifics of a state policy. Of course, that could change with another administration, because this isn't law, this is administrative policy.
Okay. Well, let's thank our speakers.